adult audience. Loveline may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised.
Loveline with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
Hey, everybody, it's Loveline. I'm Adam, that's Dr. Drew in New York. Surprise, surprise. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. Drew, are you taking control of the board tonight?
If you let me.
No, that's a disaster. You give it to me because you can't put people on hold from where you are,
no,
right?
No, I can't. Anderson and I figured out how to do it. We can do it.
Oh, all right. Yeah. And do what
it's
you want.
Time. It's a good time.
All right, so I don't see anything on my board?
Nothing. I'll take care of everything. You've been
all right,
sick.
So,
you've been sick. It's time for you to
all right, we're going to get into that. So what do I do? Write down the names of whoever calls so I know their names?
Yes, and I'll tell you their age.
All right. Well, I'm going to get rid of this screen.
So I get a desperate call from your wife. I think it was Friday morning. Early,
yeah.
Like 7 o'clock.
Yeah.
Adam's dying.
Yeah. Oh, man.
All right.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I woke up at 5 a.m. yakking. Big time. And I mean, like, you know, you're a passionate man, Drew.
Yeah.
I'm a passionate yacker.
Yeah.
Like, I throw up. I throw up.
Your wife.
I throw up like I'm yelling at somebody in traffic, you know. Just, you know what it reminds me of? My poor wife looking at me like.
Crying.
Once in a while, my cat would bring up a fur ball.
Uh-huh.
You know, as a kid, like that weird fur ball thing a cat does. Yeah! And you're like, don't bring it up here. I'm going to carry you outside. But is there anything I can do? Like, you want to shoot him, really. Just, like, take him down. Like, I'm sure if she had a pistol, she would have put a bullet in me. I was like, convulsing into the sink. And it was
she was crying. She was scared.
Oh, was she?
Yeah.
Yeah, I was violently vomiting about 5 a.m. and then whatever. And I just started to, you know, chills and sweats. And then I just kept thinking about me laugh. All that was going on in my mind was me laughing when you're telling me to take the flu shot. And I was going, I don't need any flu shot. I never get sick. Yeah. Now what? Now would that flu shot have stopped this?
It might have. It might have helped anyway. It might have made it less.
Violent yakking.
Next year.
And then, let me tell you about my wife. She, you know, so now I'm in bed. She gets up. She's on the phone with Drew. God bless her. Drew says, now let's talk about what to do with the flu, Drew.
Yeah.
You want to drink some Gatorade, right?
Yeah. It wasn't really
Why
the flu.
Why Gatorade?
Well, you were going to replace.
What did I have?
You had some sort of viral illness, but it probably a gastrointestinal, you know, it's all the viral gastroenteritis. You want to replace fluids. When your fever goes up, you lose fluids rapidly. When you have diarrhea, you lose fluids. When you vomit, obviously, you're losing fluids. So
right.
You want to make sure you replace that. Yeah.
Right.
When you have your volume up, you feel better.
Right.
It
was funny. What's funny about fluids was my wife spoke to Drew, and she said, I got this hernia thing going on, too. And
she
said, could this be the hernia? Drew wants to know if it's the hernia thing. And my hernia was, like, feeling weird the night before. I didn't say anything.
Uh-oh.
And I thought, oh, Christ, maybe this is what's going on. Maybe my hernia's pushing through my gut, and this is why I'm vomiting all over the place.
It twists off. It twists off, and then the bowel dies.
Right.
And you vomit and get abdominal pain.
So So do I have the flu or is my hernia going to explode?
Well, that's what I was asking her, and apparently you had no abdominal pain other than the retching.
I didn't have anything, and then an hour later I let a nice load of diarrhea go, and I thought, oh, thank Christ. Never been happier for some diarrhea. I was like, oh, praise the Lord. Look at that. It's a mess. It's not the hernia.
Oh, man.
So anyway.
Yeah.
I had something going at about... And, why, you know, by the way, why this stuff needs to hit at 5 a.m., for Christ's sake. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
There has to be the whole, you know, it just wouldn't be a horrible, it's like the earthquake. The earthquake hit at 5 a.m., you know? First off, you have this sort of the terror of the situation, and then you have the whole disorientation part. Like, what's going on? Turn on the light. Oh, my God, what's happening?
Yeah.
You know, I mean, whoever needs to take care of you is fast asleep, you know?
Yeah.
They don't know what's going on. Why 5 a.m.? Why not 5 p.m.? You know where I could go, like, listen, I'm not feeling so good, and I could head up, and people would be dressed and normal. You know what I mean?
Yeah, you don't have to prepare for it.
The boner and the sweatpants and stumbling around through the dark and, you know, trying to find the bathroom.
Yeah, it's so miserable.
Then it was like, and this is, by the way, the bad sign is when you get the trash can and put it by the bed. That's that was the next move. Going to need the trash can. And just yakking into that Pottery Barn bathroom trash can for the next few hours. Drew called. Drew took very good care of me, kept calling. So now what do you do, Drew? You should drink Gatorade. Why Gatorade?
That's good. It's not just water then. You see, you're replacing fluid, water plus electrolytes.
All right. So,
if you end up just replacing water, you can actually alter the sodium balance in your system and have too much free water circulating around.
So you're crapping out, you're sweating out, and you're yakking out too many fluids.
Right.
And you need
to
put fluid back, and that fluid needs to not just be H2O.
Right.
What kind of juice? What about like orange juice? Too acidic for the stomach? Or?
Yeah, if you're vomiting, that's not the good thing. You just even water can be a little tough sometimes. But you want to get water with something in it, and then slowly add the juice and things like that. Get, you know, cranberry juice, easy juices, and then take the Tylenol when your fever's going up. When you're chilling, that's how your body drives the temperature up. It's not that you're actually cold. It's your body is generating heat through the chills, and that's what's driving the temperature up. When you sweat, your body's trying to cool itself down, and that's when the temperature's on its way back down.
And what about eating?
Well, if you're vomiting, you ought to stop vomiting. Yeah, you ought to stop vomiting for a couple of hours.
Now, but here's the whole thing. If you're vomiting, and if you're vomiting, are you going to want to vomit even if there's nothing in your stomach?
Possibly.
But if you put something in your stomach, you're really going to want to vomit, right?
That's right.
I mean, you're essentially giving yourself ammunition.
Well, you have an inflamed system going there, right? And it's going to get worse when you load something on it.
Right. So you should not try to eat a saltine or anything like that.
No, I mean, eventually, within a couple of hours. If you have no vomit for a couple of hours, then it's game on.
All right.
And then there's another crazy idea people have is that everything I put in my stomach comes out my rear end as diarrhea. No, it takes hours and hours for things to get out of your stomach.
Really?
But when you put
I was getting stuff out of my mouth in record time.
Well, that's different. But when you put something in your stomach, it generates something called the gastrocolic reflex. So it stimulates your rectum to release things. Uh-huh. Whatever was down there gets pushed through.
Uh-huh.
Not what goes in your stomach is going through. You'll see that in about 12 to 24 hours.
Right. You knock over a domino, but the last one that falls out of your ass is not
that's,
the one you first knocked over.
Thank you.
So we should go on tour together.
It's good times.
So, all right. So you want to, and then what do you want to eat when you finally start eating?
Starchy foods, like
starchy
you said,
foods.
Saltine, yeah.
But
starchy,
no, you don't want like protein. Too tough to digest.
No. You want well cooked things like soup or starch.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I know you're obsessed about you recovering from viral illness right now, but let's get to the call, shall we?
No, you know what? I don't care about me. But
Huh?
You know what? I just realized that, you know, it just happened to me that, you know, people get sick and they're not sure what to do. And it's like the whole Tylenol thing. It's like, oh, is that going to be hard on my stomach? Should I be taking the Tylenol when my stomach's upset? You should be taking it.
Not Advil or aspirin, because that is hard on your stomach.
Well, see, there you go.
There you go.
I'm just saying, a lot of people listening want to. So, I mean, the beats are the Gatorade and the Tylenol, really, when you got that crazy fever, right?
That's what it boils down to.
And
you know, there was some data every 4 hours. You know, there was some data that came out recently about antibiotics and breast cancer, that the more antibiotics you use, the higher your risk of breast cancer in women. So there's even now, beyond the fact that you're also polluting the environment now with resistant organisms if you use a lot of antibiotic, there's now personal and good reason not to take a lot of antibiotics, perhaps.
All right. Well, anyway, just to quiet down, finish up my story. I felt a little better, thanks to Dr. Drew, and then started yakking again into the afternoon and evening, and then sweat it all out. Felt great next night.
You didn't sweat out anything.
I sweat it all out.
You broke a
and
sweat.
I went out, you know what? I went out eating Mexican last night. Hell yes. Let me tell you something. When you haven't eaten in a day and a half, and you've eaten nothing but a can of Progresso vegetable soup and 6 quarts of Gatorade, you want Mexican. you don't want sushi.
And you might want barbecue too, right?
You might want. I got a barbecue taco. I swear to Christ.
See.
You want grease. You know what I'm saying?
Maybe that's
how Mexican food got started in Mexico, which is everyone was just hungover and wanted Mexican.
Maybe it's all those gastroenterologic pathogens, all that diarrhea and vomiting they get.
No, but Drew, explain. I don't know, real quick. How does that work? Where you what? Just
you just want had, calories? Your body had, wants to restore itself.
Hadn't eaten in a day and a half. I wanted grease. I wanted meat. I wanted cheese. You know, I wanted a mess. Maybe I don't want fat. Anything good.
You want calories.
All right.
You want calories.
That's
yeah,
it.
That's good. And then they all taste good. It's satisfying then, too, right?
No, yeah.
Yes.
All right. Where are we going?
All right. Here we go. We are going to go to Irene, who is 16. Irene?
Oh, hi.
What's happening, Irene?
By the way, I heard you guys when you're talking, Drew curses a lot. It was really weird to hear that. Sorry, I just had to tell you that. But
Oh, you were on hold?
Yeah.
Drew,
really
he used the S word, didn't he?
He used the F word.
S, right?
No, he used both of them.
Who used the F word, too?
Yeah, he said that people...
Hey, bah, 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 bah.
Unacceptable.
Okay, sorry.
Drew's a man of extreme passion.
Uh-huh.
And Irene was on hold, and Drew and I were talking to each other
and
before
I was
the
yelling,
show during
I was
the break.
Yelling, I was yelling about how people claim to know their bodies. And I was saying, they don't. They don't. They
right, don't. Don't use the F word again,
I
Drew.
I won't use it. I won't use it.
Sorry.
It's real, right?
I get really freaked out when people curse, so.
Yeah, sorry. I'm sorry for my partner. Now, I didn't curse. I didn't curse, right?
You did.
No, you didn't. It was weird.
Yeah,
thank you.
It is weird, Adam. It was a problem.
All right. Go ahead.
Okay, so they keep on having these commercials. They've been going on for a few months now on, the main station here for this thing called Level RB. And it sounds pretty much like a drug, and it's just saying it'll relax you, it'll put you in a euphoria, it'll make all your troubles go away, but it's not addictive like a drug, and it's not illegal, so call this number and get it. And I don't understand what in the world it is, because it sounds just like I don't know much about drugs, but it sounds like one of them. And
yeah, well, what do you care? You want to take it?
Depends what kind of mood I'm in.
Oh, really? You don't like swearing, but you like taking drugs?
I've never taken drugs.
All right. I would yell up if I could that in the same way I did about people knowing their bodies, which is if a chemical causes euphoria, it's a drug. I don't care if you're from chewing on a leaf. That's where coca leaf got discovered. The people would chew on the coca leaf.
I know. Sherlock Holmes took cocaine.
Right. And so this is if it affects your brain, it's a chemical.
Okay. It's
a drug.
Thing, you know?
It sounds like some sort of herbal. If it's over the counter, it must be under the sort of category of food supplements, and it's got to be some sort of
All right, but Drew, give it. Basically, none of the supplements you hear on the radio.
Well,
work
some of these
anything.
Things do, but again, if they do have a subtle effect, they have a pharmacological
it's
effect.
Like diet pills.
Well, like ephedra had an effect, but it was harming people, so it needed to be taken off the market. And ephedra is converted into amphetamine by your system. And so really, you were taking amphetamine when you took ephedra.
Oh, can I ask you a question about drugs?
Hold on.
Would you put her on hold, Drew?
No,
Christ's sake, get rid of her.
And when you...
I'm a sick man.
I know. It's hard. And when if you're taking any chemical that has mind-altering effects and you need that, you should have that assessed, properly diagnosed, and properly treated. Even people that know infinitely more than you about depression and anxiety and these things would never dream of administering medicines to themselves.
All right. Here's what Drew's saying in a nutshell. First off, every drug, whether legal or illegal, that's out there is all some plant-based thing that ends up being synthesized at some point, but it's all just made from poppies or cocoa leaves or whatever, whatever we go and find. It's all the heroin and the coke and all that stuff.
That's right.
Right. It's all just out there. So who cares what you're calling it? If it's messing with your mind, and then it's messing with your mind.
That's right. This is Molly, who's 18. Molly.
Yeah.
What's happening, Molly?
Hey, I wanted to know what could cause someone to enjoy biting people and liking to be bit.
To be bit.
Yeah.
I don't know that we can say that there's a specific event that causes something like that, but it obviously it's a kind of an aggression, right?
Yeah, it's an aggressive
outlet of some type that you can't seem to express through more sort of direct means, so you do this very, very primitive thing of biting.
Yeah, but, you know, there is something sexual about it.
Oh, yeah.
That digs a little deeper, and, you know what, Drew? Women like it a little more than guys.
In
their own weird way. I'll tell you, here's an interesting thing, Drew. Most women, and listen up, young engineer Chris, because the chicks dig this, and I know you're sort of, new in your career.
We're going to get into the rough trade discussion again.
Well, okay, that too. The point is most women like a little nibbling on the neck, if you think about it. And Drew?
Sometimes.
Yeah, as a man of great passion, who's downed many a candy striper in his day, you know what I'm talking about. Now, I'm not talking about drawing blood. I'm just talking about that sort of jaw on the jugular kind of thing. And I'm not talking about exacting any pressure. I'm just talking about having it there. And if you sort of go back and you think about animals and stuff, that's where they go.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I mean, there's got to be some sort of old instinct, kind
absolutely.
Of ancestral thing for that, right?
Of course, absolutely.
And women maybe are a little more in touch with that than guys because, I don't know, they would be on the losing end of it more often, or I don't know what that is. Uh-oh, I just heard myself.
No, we're good.
All right, who are you talking to, Drew?
We're going to talk to John, who's calling from...
Who are you talking to saying you're good?
No, Drew. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to worry about the click you heard.
Oh, okay. So what do you think of that?
I think that's right. I mean, again, if you think about sort of how male mammals approach female, oftentimes there's sort of a biting and pulling and that kind of stuff. So it's some primitive throwback to our past, I'm sure.
All right, but if you got to do it all the time or you're drawing blood or you're getting obsessed about
then you're messed up. Be correct. This is now Vicky, 18.
Hello?
What's happening, Vicky?
Hi, not much. How are you doing?
Good. Well, I'm better now.
That's good. I have had this friend since first grade, and she's my roommate now, and we're both 18, and we're in college now, and we're just taking like general classes, and just like about a week ago, I think, I don't know what happened, but for some reason, I think I started to become attracted to her, which is really weird because I don't like girls, and like I have a boyfriend and everything too.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know. I mean, I think if I told her, I'd probably like totally freak her out.
You feeling like sexually attracted?
Kind of like I accidentally like walked past her and she was like getting dressed, and like she looked really good.
Have you had same-sex feelings in the past?
No, it was actually just like the first time I ever felt that way.
Where was she getting dressed?
The bathroom. She just got out of the shower.
Ooh. Is there anything else about your past or history that we should know that might make you sort of confused about your sexual orientation?
No, really.
I'm telling you. Drew, I'm telling you.
I'm just asking.
Quiet down. I don't care about that. I'm talking about heterosexual chicks.
Have a thing
and gay
for
guys.
Yeah,
they got
yeah.
it made in that locker room. The gay guys, they get to go scope out on the guy junk. The heterosexual chicks get to go check out heterosexual chicks who they're sort of attracted to in some way anyway, or at least appreciate.
Sort of like
you go into the car show and just sort of looking around and appreciating and then getting back in your pile of ass and driving home. And then you got the lesbian chicks who get to go, you know what I mean? Everyone gets something in that locker room but us straight guys.
The
guys who deserve it the most, the guys who work the hardest, we get nothing. We get as big sacks. We get big hairy asses and scrotum sacks and old guys shooting pool in the Y. We get revolted. You know what I mean? Like we got a wretch. And everyone else gets something. It's not right. I'm going to change that, Drew.
All right, what are you going
to do? Believe me, I'll be doing something. Believe you me. And when I do, you'll know, because I'll be doing it.
So, Vicky, what we're saying basically, and you'll know, and we'll all know, huh? It's just kind of cool out. It's a normal thing. It doesn't necessarily mean anything.
Yeah, you don't have to do anything about it, do you?
You have a boyfriend. We wouldn't tell you to act on those sorts of feelings if it was towards another guy either, because it's just you have a boyfriend. All right?
Yeah.
All right, good.
All right. Fantastic.
Wait a minute. Put her on hold.
She's back now?
She was
okay,
there.
Okay, but here's what if you feel like you're ignoring a calling? You know what
well,
I mean?
Well, that's not what she said. She goes, it was sort of out of the blue, surprising. I've never had that before. It's like, all right,
yeah,
fine.
Yeah, but then then you start thinking, maybe this is my proclivity,
yeah,
and I'm ignoring it.
At 15, you
but
think
not
that.
At 18?
At 18, you should kind of have your card sorted out at that point. But it's possible, but she'll know it. She'll keep preoccupying about it. That's what I'm saying. Just cool your jets, see what happens here.
Wait till I do something about this locker room thing, bro.
Yeah, I can't wait.
Man, I'm this close to making a move, too.
Really?
Yeah, I've been biding my time for a while getting ready. I didn't want to talk about it because it was going to be a complete surprise, but I'm going to make a move, and it's going to be soon. And when it is, you'll know, you know?
Speaking of making a move, I talked to a guy today who was we used to work over at Politically Incorrect, mm-hmm. and he was the guy that Natalie from the Dixie Chicks called to get in touch with you to be the date to the Grammys some 3 or 4 years ago.
Really?
That led to all the craziness with the panties and the flowers and
sure.
all that.
Sure, sure.
Yeah. Turns out you weren't her first choice.
Oh.
Turns out you weren't.
You're breaking my heart. Who's first? Mark DiCarlo?
No. It was sort of an A-list to begin with, but she called up and asked for Brad Pitt's phone number. That's what
all
she
right.
asked for.
Yeah. All right, well, she asked for Brad Pitt.
And then she worked her way down. She finally got to Thomas Calabro, apparently, and then kept going. Remember Thomas Calabro?
Thomas Calabro, from Beverly Hills.
Melrose, I think it was.
Yeah, he was the doctor from Melrose Place.
But
yeah.
She kept going. She kept bugging him. Who else could go out with me? And she got to Adam Carolla.
Really? Thomas Calabro was in front of me?
Yes.
Wow. Well, now look at it. Look at me. It's Sunday night, and I'm doing radio. And where's that Brad Pitt? I don't think he's on the radio. No, I don't think he is at all. He's in the Malibu Colonies banging the bejesus out of Jennifer Aniston. That's right. I'm on the radio. I have a plan to correct the nudity locker room situation. Not Brad. He's got no plan. He's got no radio. That's right.
And all you won't know about him, but we'll hear from you, Adam.
Oh,
because we're all going to hear
it.
About this locker room,
you'll
Adam.
Know
we'll
it.
All know.
You people will all know it when I unleash my plan on the world. All right. Let's take a break here, Drew.
Yeah, let's unleash.
Wow, that's breaking my heart.
I'm sorry, but I couldn't resist.
She didn't tell me anything about Thomas Calabro. All right. We'll take a quick break. Drew over there in New York, me here in L.A., and we'll be right back after this. It's Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Drew's in New York. I'm in L.A. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Drew, a mensch, as the Jewish people say. Salt of the earth, this man. I was on my deathbed all day on Friday. Drew called, I think, must have been 3 times to see how I was doing and tell me to take the Tylenol and all that kind of stuff. And producer Ann, I was too sick and caved in on Friday night, so I didn't see the Kimmel show. But producer Ann mentioned to me that a couple of folks that Jimmy had mentioned on the show that much of the staff was sick with the stomach flu, but the only one who didn't show up for work was Carolla.
He actually said it on the air.
Yes, and this brings me to a good point, which is, listen, you a-holes, if you're sick, we don't need any heroes. Do not drag your ass to work. It's great for you. It's bad for the one guy who didn't choose to drag his ass to work. And there's no way they could have.
And you're also passing it around, too.
Well, yes. Yes, that's what you're doing, Johnny Hero. You're getting everyone at work sick. Now are you happy, Mr. Work Ethic? And by the way, we don't need your kind here. Move to Japan. All right? You go to Japan. You want to bring that kind of work ethic into your environment. We don't need any heroes. You go to Japan and bust your ass, and you go to the place where if you get like a B minus, you jump off a building on the bell tower. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, I don't need that, Drew.
Okay.
So here's the point. I called the Kimmel show to say, I'm sick. I'm not coming in. The chick who answered the phone was like, yeah, I had the same thing last night. And by the way, it's always subtly degrading when they give you that. Yeah, I had the same thing. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Nope. Vomiting. Nope. Same thing. I'm just a better person than you. That's why I'm picking up the phone. I'm at work. You understand? You're not coming in. But no, I had the exact same thing. Maybe worse. Probably worse. But here
that's
I am. So the chick who answered the phone had the same thing. She then, I'm hearing an echo, by the way, and it's driving me nuts. Uh-oh. She then passed me off to my buddy Rick over there, who had the same thing, too. And at first, I felt like, well, good. See, this is going around. And then my next thought is, all these a-holes showed up, and it's going to be, well, who's the only one who called in sick? Well, it's Carolla boy. But Drew, back me up as a doctor. There's no way they could have had what I had.
No, especially you tend to not have much reaction to bad viruses. I mean, it's any viruses for that matter, but this one really got you.
I'm going to need a note.
And that's what I've always said is, Adam, you've never really been sick. Because when you're sick, you can't get up. You can't go to work. It's just you can't.
Well, what is it? I mean, so why am I lying in bed, writhing in pain, sweating profusely, and like moaning into space and yakking into a trash can, and these people yacked the night before and got up and went to work?
Why does that happen to me every time I get a virus, and you've never had that happen before? It's just one of them things. Yeah, we don't know.
All right, so is it that we didn't have the same virus, me and everyone who was at work, or I reacted differently?
It affected you differently. Yeah.
All right, well, good times.
Yeah, good times. Here's
that'll be a great sell tomorrow, by the way.
Yeah. Oh, they're going to love you.
The one guy didn't show up. All right, I'm going to have to produce bile, actually. I'm going to have to vomit on the writer's table tomorrow.
Jennifer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's happening?
Well, I had sex like a month ago for like my first time, and then he broke up with me, and ever since, I just want to have like random sex. I don't know.
Well, that to me suggests you were sort of traumatized by the sex. Was it a kind of a bad experience?
I don't know. It took him like 7 months, and he just pressured me and pressured me and pressured me, and so I finally just gave in.
How old's Jennifer?
I'm 17.
17. Shout that out, each name, Drew.
I did.
I said shout it.
Okay.
I didn't hear it.
Okay, got it.
Stop mumbling. And then I'll tell you about my plan for the locker room later.
Okay, then I'll shout loud.
Okay, so wait, he pressured you for 7 months. You gave in, so you sort of feel like he manipulated you.
Yeah.
And then he broke up with you.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then he leaves, and all of a sudden she has an urge to do this over and over again. Did you? Where's your dad?
I live with him.
And has he always been in your life?
Well, he got custody of me from my mom whenever I was like 2.
Yeah. Mm-mm. From your mom. What happened with your mom?
She just did a lot of drugs.
Okay.
And neglected me.
Yeah, that's bad times.
Yeah, this kind of neglect and abandonment. When somebody does that to you after an intimate contact, that can be awfully, awfully painful for you after having had that horrible trauma when you were a child. So, and one of the things that the human brain does when it sort of gets into a traumatic... When there's trauma from the past that is resurrected by experiences in your adult life, it makes you repeat those things. It's almost as though you compulsively go and repeat the traumas over and over again. And I think that's what you're trying to do, as though somehow you can master it or get control over it. Now, even to talk about it rationally almost doesn't even make sense. The fact is, this has resurrected some very old feelings, and it must have been very painful when your boyfriend left. And you're trying to fix that by doing these random sex acts, which is going to only make you feel worse.
I used to try to fix it by beating off. Yeah, at first I thought I was going to fix it by sex, and then that wasn't an option. I had to downgrade that to beating off. Yeah, I had to simulate it. I had to climb in the simulator. It's like saying, first I thought I would beat it by just climbing up into that F-18 and soaring off into the skies, and then when I realized I couldn't get hold of one, I had to sneak into the simulator.
And then just down to the video game.
And then down to like Top Gun video game. Yeah. All right.
Good times. Jennifer, you basically have two choices. You can find a relationship and try again and be very, very careful with whom you choose, because you're likely to choose people that will abandon.
Yeah.
Or you can get some therapy. Mm-hmm. Those are your choices.
I've already been down that road. And
well, as long as you've been down that road. I mean, yeah. At the ripe old age of 17.
Yeah. Well, it was for other things, like me being molested and everything.
All right, there we go.
Well, why don't you head down that road again?
Having the traumas being that deep and that intense, you're going to have to be with her for a long, long, long time, okay?
Okay. We'll look into it again.
Okay.
Yeah, let me tell you something about therapy. It's a very long road, and about every quarter mile, you got to stop and empty your pockets. And there's an ATM like every 6 miles.
Let's take a Florida or Germany.
All right.
This is Dallas. 16!
Hey, how's it going?
What the hell was that?
You told me to yell out the age.
Oh, yeah.
Remember?
Start yelling that name out, Drew. Yeah.
The age, the name, too?
No, that's fine. Just Dallas, 16.
Yeah. Okay.
It was like you're saying 16 when somebody stepped on your foot.
Well, you said yell it.
No, I liked it. All right. Go ahead, Dallas.
A man was arrested for stalking several women.
Mm-hmm.
One woman claimed that he had literally snuck into her bed while she was sleeping and snuggled up with her. While another later claimed that he was folding her laundry in her sleep.
Mm-hmm.
That's very much it.
Mm-hmm. Everybody in Florida? That's it?
Ooh. That's it, huh?
Germany! Yes. All Florida! It's Germany! All Florida!
Germany.
Yeah, I'm going Germany, too.
Yep, you're both right.
Hey,
yeah.
You got our mojo back.
Hey, Dallas. Dallas.
Yes.
16, yes?
Yes.
Yeah.
Virgin, yes?
God, yes.
Yes. All right, buddy. Keep up the bad work.
He means God, no. But
I can hear it in his voice.
He's supposed to be at 16.
This show... 16-year-old guys, what percentage of 16-year-olds who call this show are virgins?
They call this show 20%.
Virgins? Yeah, maybe 25.
Yeah.
Maybe 25. Maybe 15. And what percentage of the populace, 16?
60%.
Virgins?
I'm going to guess. That data is all over the map, but I'm going to say that 60%.
Yeah. 60% of the guys, but less of the women, or you think it's the other way around?
It's amazingly pretty similar.
Really?
Yeah.
And it doesn't seem like you just sort of spin that any direction you want to spin it if you're trying to make a point.
The populations around this country in different areas and regions and urban versus suburban, so different. It's really hard to interpret the data that's out.
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting thing. Like, you know, if you're living in Norway in 1950 and you want to go out and take yourself a little census poll, it's not going to take too long, right?
No.
I mean, just get a handful of blonde-haired people and figure out what's up, right?
Yeah, that's right.
I mean, this country is such a
so
collage.
Diverse. Yeah, yeah.
And collage is that's a euphemism.
What's the other collage-like art that you used to do?
Decoupage?
Decoupage. It's a decoupage.
Look at Drew with his French. Decoupage. Yeah. It's more of a mosaic. This country, but it's hard to figure out what the hell's going on because there's so many different zones and people and regions and right.
That's right.
All right,
it is very hard. So, all right, let's take a tough call here. This is Shannon 20. Shannon.
Yeah.
Hi there.
My question is, I just found out on Friday that my dad has cancer. He starts chemo tomorrow, and the doctors gave him about 6 months to live.
What kind of cancer does he have?
I'm still kind of confused about it. I think that it started in his esophagus and it spread to his liver.
Why do they give him chemo if they're only giving him 6 months?
I don't understand that
either. It's a try to get a little more time.
What I'm worried is just going to make him, like, sicker.
It does. It sometimes does, and it often doesn't accomplish much with these solid tumors. Are they going to put a line directly into his liver or anything like that?
I'm really not sure. I didn't really know.
Okay. And are they doing any surgeries?
No, it's inoperable.
Is he a smoker?
Yeah.
And a drinker?
No.
Okay. So those are the two things that put people at risk for esophageal cancer.
How old is he?
He's 59.
Sorry.
So Drew.
Yeah.
They'll give you chemo even if they know it's inoperable.
You know, one of the things that drives me insane is that...
Okay, go ahead. But don't start cussing. Don't start cussing again.
I feel like it when things drive me insane. But most solid tumors are inoperable. And so when you go for a cancer surgery, you're just having the tumor sort of brought the side, the amount of it taken down, so you get some extra time. But once you've found a cancer, it has spread all over the place.
What's the difference between a solid tumor and a non-solid tumor?
Like a lymphoma or a leukemia is not a solid tumor. Lung, liver, pancreas.
Those are solid.
Esophagus. Those are adenocarcinomas.
All right. So if they say we're not going to operate, this is terminal. I don't know. Is there? I mean, I guess there's a big difference between living for 3 months and living for 9 months. Well, but I mean, what if you're getting sick and you're going undergoing treatment?
But I'm sure they've discussed all that with him, and there must be. I don't know the literature on esophageal cancer off the top of my head, but there must be some potential of longer term outcome. And I think there is some new protocols, if I remember right. I'm pretty sure I've read about that have given people 1, 3, and 5 year survivals here and there. And so there might be a chance of breaking through that six-month window. You see that, Shannon?
Yeah.
But nonetheless, it's still a shock, and it's still, you know, you're going to go through a lot of denial and wanting to sort of forget about it, not think about it. And when he's normal, you're just going to let it go. But you got to begin preparing yourself that although you don't know when, you now know what he's going to die of.
Yeah, I know. I'm just, like, really scared and, like, confused. And
Do you have any siblings?
Yeah.
How many?
Two.
How old are they?
25 and 27.
Are you talking with them?
A little bit. I guess, like, my sister's just, like, as freaked out as I am. And
yeah.
What brought him in to the hospital in the first place?
Weight loss?
I guess, yeah, he has lost a lot of weight, and I guess he was just, like, having really bad stomach problems. And
yeah. Are you close with your siblings?
Yeah.
Do you have good friends?
Yeah, actually, I have really good friends. They drove 2.5 hours to see me when I found out.
This is the time to rely on your friends. This is when you really lean on them. Don't be afraid to ask for help. This is that time.
Yeah.
There's sort of no one can take this away from you, but having support around will make a big, big difference.
Are there any, like, good support groups or anything?
Most hospitals will have various kinds of cancer support groups. You got to talk to the oncology department there, wherever he's being treated, okay?
Okay.
All right, Shannon.
Sorry, Shannon.
Good luck.
Hang in there. It's going to be all right.
Call us back. Tell us how it's working out.
Okay. Thanks.
All right. Take care.
Okay.
All right. Oh, very sad.
Yeah. Thanks.
Yeah, that when they tell you, they give you 6 months, that's probably
not a good sign. But occasionally people will sort of go longer than that. But the solid tumors, they suck. Well, but good times. We're going to take a wart call next. And first we're going to have a break.
All right. And we'll be right back after this. Yeah! Hey, everybody. It's Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191er. All right, Drew's in New York. Drew, when are you coming back?
Tomorrow.
Tomorrow?
Yeah.
All right, what are you doing? Something with a condom?
It's raining a little bit out there, huh?
Yeesh.
In LA? Yeah.
Holy macaroli. It is not stopped.
That's what I heard.
It rained for about 14, 15 hours straight yesterday. Let me tell you the thing about when it rains. I like it when it rains and all that kind of stuff. I'm working on a house right now, so it's always a bitch when it rains because everything gets wet and screwed up. But I don't want to be a hypocrite because I remember the summer when I was complaining that it never rains. Yeah. But I like to drive around like on the freeway and see all the sprinklers going off on the side of the freeway.
and then hearing about how we have water shortage.
Yeah. If you drive in LA and you just drive along, there's something that's it's like seeing the fire chief's house on fire. You know, it's sort of ironic. It's funny when you're driving along and it's pouring rain and driving through puddles and been raining for 2 days and just seeing those big sprinklers going off everywhere. And I was thinking, we haven't solved that mystery yet as a city. Like, listen, there are devices, and there's actually interesting devices, Drew, that obviously they don't use, but you can get them for your house.
That'll assess the water intake and turn the machine off?
Yeah. You want to know how it works?
How?
I'll tell you how, but I'm not going to tell you about my gaze in the bathroom idea just yet, because I haven't really worked that out
yet. But when you've worked it out, we will know.
Here's how this thing works. It is like a little trough thing, and you put it outside, and it's got a couple wires on it, and when the thing gets filled up with enough water, it completes the electrical circuit.
That makes perfect
sense. Yeah, you would think it would be a weight or something have to do with a magnet or a counterweight or something. No, it's just the electricity will pass through the water, go in, and shut the valve off. You can order these things. But, all this city talks about is how we live in a desert and how we need to be drought conscious and how this and how that. Go drive around. I mean, it's I'm working on an arc out here, Drew. There's enough room for you, not the wife. You and
two,
one of the
two
kids.
By two. Oh, that means you and I.
The kids. Go make Sophie's Choice when you get home tonight, tomorrow. But the point is why are we firing these sprinklers off in the middle of these rainstorms? And how come we haven't figured this out? And you think this goes on in Europe?
Rhetorical question. Here's Francisco, who's 26.
Right. Yeah, I am. I'm in love with a woman that I met in November, and this week she told me that
you're gay.
She had genital warts last year. We haven't had sex yet, but we want to, and now she told me this. So I'm thinking how to proceed.
You're going to wear a condom is what you're going to do.
Right. What else do you suggest?
Well, you have two choices. You can wear a condom and reduce your risk as much as possible. Because she still has the virus, obviously, because that doesn't go away. I mean, it certainly doesn't go away in a year. There's a certain percentage of the wart viruses do go away after 5 to 10 years.
Yeah, well, they're getting married.
And the ones that you are getting married?
No, we're not getting married. No.
Oh, I thought you wanted to get married. Say something about getting married?
I think you were. Did you take some cold medicine or something before?
I should have been dating this girl for what's
her name? November.
I don't know why I heard Mary. Is her name Mary or something? I'm going insane.
Yeah, all right. You are. Where was I? The wart viruses that do remit, that means go away by themselves within a few years, are the ones that are not associated with cervical cancer so much. But you can't know which one she's got, and I guarantee you it's not gone away in a year. So she's got it still, and all you can do is either A, not have sex with her, or B, reduce your risk by wearing a condom.
So when you are talking about reducing my risk, wearing a condom does not guarantee protection.
Not with this one, because it's a skin virus, and there's obviously skin exposed elsewhere, down towards the base of the penis and stuff.
But it's pretty good, right?
It's pretty good. It's pretty good, though.
How about oral sex?
You know.
Come on, give him a doctor's note on this one, Drew.
Yeah, you're probably going to be okay with that.
Oh, no.
my mouth.
Hold on. He's got to put the condom on, but it's okay if he goes down on her?
There is such a thing as that being transmitted, but that's pretty unusual.
That's a 1-2 in the gut there, Drew.
Yeah, sorry.
Come on.
That's the way it goes, though.
Hey, listen, Drew, let me tell you this.
What?
When I'm in charge, I will, like whenever these politicians are running for governor or councilman or whatever, mayor, they're always talking about balancing the budget and everything. I'm going to focus on things like the sprinklers running while it's raining.
And
you know what I mean? Like stuff. And I'm going to say stuff like, you know those signs on the freeway that say 15-foot clearance?
Yes.
And then have the big zero for the inches? No more zeros. It's just going to say 15-foot when I'm in charge. You can do the math. We don't need 15-foot zero. I don't tell anyone I am 6-foot. Zero. Just 6-foot, right?
Yes,
you don't ask after that, right? We're going to save millions on printing, on signs. I'm going to force the guys who put the manhole covers back with the stripes going the wrong way, with the road stripe, to line them back up. Don't you think I could win? Don't you think I could win based on that stuff?
It'll be a utopia.
But just the stuff that you notice. You know what I mean? Like all this other BS no one ever notices. Like, we're going to remove asbestos from schools, and we're going to balance the budget, and I got a state transportation act or something. BS. Let's do stuff you can look at. You know, stuff you drive past, stuff you see. Yeah?
And save money on it.
Yeah, I'm just saying. Wouldn't you like a guy just talk about the sprinklers being on while it's raining?
Yes.
You get your
matters.
Vote,
practical
wouldn't
matters. Yeah, practical matters.
Thank you.
Like, why didn't the other guys think of that?
This guy's
on the ball. He's thinking of detail.
That's right.
And we're on the ball, too, and we're going to break.
Oh, boy, Drew, that's good radio. All right, we'll be right back after this. Hey, everybody, it's Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew over there in New York. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. You know, Drew?
Yeah.
When I was on my deathbed over the weekend, just writhing in pain.
And I was at home wringing my hands with concern.
Yes, worrying. Drew called, I think, three times to
Those are the ones you know of.
Those are the ones I know of. Well, I did. My wife did tell me that I think he called another time. God bless Drew. We both agreed. It's salt of the earth, this Drew. But I had to laugh. I was in more pain than I've been in years. Just you know, the thing about this flu is like every joint hurt. My head was throbbing. I just wanted to die, you know. And I was just lying there, but I had a little diarrhea too, and asking.
Yeah.
And I was blasting some pretty good farts, although cautionary farts, you know, like a sort of be careful, don't just cock the arm and hike the leg and start blasting away like I normally do, because this is a hair trigger. There's a fine line here.
Yes.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes. It
did destroy a pair of long johns at a certain point. But the point
with this illness or one time in your life?
No, this time around. This time
around. That's nice. That's good times.
Yeah. I'll tell you the comedy. Well, okay. But the comedy was, even still, lying on my deathbed and barely able to move a joint, I was still able to do a little bit of the comforter flap, you know, after a good fart. No, that's to nice. Myself.
Just for yourself,
that's
your
the
own
worst
appreciation.
Part.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No one else to appreciate it but you.
Yeah, let me tell you a little comedy routine here, Drew. And folks, if you're squeamish, you may want to shut the radio off now. But did don the long johns? Did slide into those? Making those in the ivory color, probably not the greatest plan.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Just in general, old miners wearing them and whatnot, people camping. You wear long johns. When you put on those long johns, you may put them on for a few days, maybe a week sometimes, before they come off again.
That's a commitment. It's a commitment.
Pick another color. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
But that's confidence is what it is. But put the long johns on. I had the stomach upset and a little, you know, had the flu. And messed myself a little bit down there. Just a little bit. Just enough to know, you know?
How do you clean that up with your Sherwood Forest you've got?
Well, here's the interesting. I got myself cleaned up okay. But then noticed the long johns weren't in great shape.
Yeah.
And then decided that I would clean the long johns without taking them off. I was so like
you're like a cowboy. You just get in the lake with your clothes on.
I thought, how am I going to clean the back of these long johns without actually removing them?
Did you actually soap everything down with the long johns on?
I'm not a big soap guy, Drew. You know,
no,
it's like reeing.
Right.
I don't believe in it.
Yeah.
But I knew they needed a rinsing and they needed them now. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So here's how I did it. I pulled the long john. I got them down to about knee level, about mid-thigh level, and then pulled the back part around to the front. Okay? Then got on my tiptoes and seeing if I could pull that front long enough to get it under the sink, get under the water there. I was about an inch short. So I started mashing myself against the thing. At a certain point, I realized, what are you, retarded? Just take the goddamn long johns off like a human being.
Yeah. Like, what are you trying to prove?
I had to prove something to myself, Drew. Yeah,
I guess so.
I ended up taking them off, and they're back on.
Right now?
Wait a minute. Yeah, they were on later on that day after they dried out.
Okay, of course.
Thank you. All right.
Yeah, there we go.
Mm-hmm.
Let's take some calls, shall we?
Didn't need any soap. Not that I know of. Who are we talking to, Drew?
We are talking to, wait a second here, we're talking to Tina, 25.
Hi, how are you?
I'm Tina.
What's happening, Tina?
I'm having an affair with my boss.
Mm-hmm. Fabulous, fabulous.
Tina, by the way, like the number one transvestite he, she name. You know
really?
What I'm saying, Drew?
I don't know why.
Tina, yeah. You got to watch out. Watch out for the tall chicks named Tina with the Adam's apple.
Huh. Okay.
Yeah. All right. So you're having an affair with your boss?
Yes.
And it's an affair because he's married?
He's married with two children.
And what about you?
I'm single.
Okay. Mm-hmm. How old is he?
He's 33.
She's 25. And how long has this been going on for?
About a year.
And what's he been telling you? My wife's horrible to me. She doesn't treat me right. That kind of stuff.
No, he's been pretty honest about that.
That he's not leaving his wife.
No, he's not leaving his wife.
All
right. But I want to end it.
All right, good.
Because I think I can do better than this.
Yeah, how about an actual relationship would be better?
Yeah, yeah. You'd do better with a hobo who's was wearing my long johns from yesterday.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Imagine what hobo long johns would smell like, Drew.
Well, not a lot different than yours, evidently.
At least that was just sick, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm glad you're feeling better, Adam.
Oh, thanks, baby doll. So you want to end it, and?
I don't know what to do.
Well, you think he's going to be mad?
Yeah.
I think you got to change your job. What kind of work do you do?
I'm going to lose my job.
What kind of job do you do?
I'm a waitress.
You just change jobs. Get
the guy's the manager at the restaurant?
Yeah.
Of course.
Oh, Drew, hold on.
Shocking.
Scrape myself up off the floor.
Wait a minute. I've never heard of such a thing.
Listen, let me let me tell all you chicks that are married to the restaurant manager.
He needs a new job.
He's banging somebody.
Yes, husband needs a new job.
All these restaurant managers, these sons of bitches. It's like they're like quiet celebrities. You know what I mean? They don't have all the trappings. It's even better because a celebrity wants to screw around. He ends up in the tabloids.
Mm.
And it's just a fresh batch of hot new poontang that rolls into town like every 6 months trying to apply to be hostesses and cocktail waitresses.
That must be why those guys take that job. Anybody who's married to a restaurant manager needs to test their marriage by asking him to find a new job. Different kind of work.
So, yeah, listen. So you're a waitress. So you quit. You go get a new job.
Yeah, go somewhere else. Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe don't even quit. I mean, plan your escape. Find the next job. Then you quit. Then you move.
Is he going to try to talk you out of it?
Probably.
Of course.
And
of course.
Why does he expect you to go along with this with no promises?
Why not? He's got it made.
No, yeah, I know why.
We understand why he wants to, but why would he?
You didn't answer my question. You just restated it.
Why would he
expect you to go along with it?
Why would
I don't know?
Right. What is it about you?
That's much more satisfying.
Yeah. What is it about you, Tina, that would lead him to believe that you would put up with an abusive situation like this? How about that?
Oh, I've had a lot of. I was sexually assaulted when I was a child.
Yeah. There you go.
Yeah.
That's what we're talking about.
All right. I can hear it in your voice. You sound
broken.
Like you've been through the ringer. Yeah. All right. Hey, Tina.
Yeah.
Come to your own defense.
First day of the rest of your life, baby doll.
Yeah.
Let's go now. It's a Sunday. Tomorrow's Monday.
Break it down.
Let's get going now. Let's break it down now. Let's break it down. Let's get a hand in now, all right? Don't sit on your helmets. Grab a knee. Helmet's not a chair. Tina, I want you to get a hand in. I want you to break it down now. Now, you find a new gig. And here's the thing, too. Don't announce to this guy, I agree with Drew. And when I agree with Drew, you know I must be telling the truth.
Hmm.
Do not go in and announce to this guy that you want to break up. And when you do that, like, I'm going to break up with you thing, you're not saying I want to break up. You're saying talk me out of it.
Yeah, yeah.
The way to break up with someone is to break up with them.
Yeah, or stop doing the things that makes me want to break up with you, which he's never going to do.
Right. Find your new gig. Get a hand in. Break it down. Yeah,
Drew. Get out of there.
That's right. Grab a knee. Don't sit on your helmet, though. Grab a knee.
You need to think of something more inspiring than that.
That's all they used to say to us. Don't sit on your helmet. Just listen. Find a new job. Quietly find a new job over the next couple of weeks. Get that gig. Secure your schedule to your new job. Quit and walk away. You owe this man nothing. He's lucky you're not blowing the whistle on him. Yeah. Thank you. All right.
This now is Mike, who's 21.
Hey, I'm here in Salt Lake City. What's up?
Yeah, Mormons. Get a hand in, Mormons.
I'm not Mormon.
You a Mormon?
Yeah, polygamy. Get a hand in.
What's up?
I'm Armenian, so, well, I...
You a Mormon?
Yeah, the only Armenian in Salt Lake. Get a hand in. Get a kebab in.
I have a problem with Loratabs.
You're addicted to Loratab.
Yeah.
That's pretty common.
Not just Loratabs, but like Vicodin and...
It's all opiates.
It's the same thing, right?
It's all the same stuff. Loratab and Vicodin are precisely the same thing, just a little different doses.
Oh, Drew, let me ask you about that for a second.
All right.
Myself.
I was thinking to myself as I was during the break at the top of the hour, I was taking a pee and thinking, geez, suddenly when it's important to Adam, it's important to all of us. Suddenly
right.
You're interested in medical problems.
No, how dare you?
True.
No, it's not important to me because I get the flu every 6 years and I just got it.
So it's and not tonight be, it's important to you, so we're talking about it.
No, it's not going to be important to me for another 6 years, is what I'm saying, jack off.
Because you're making my point for me. Other people may think it's important a lot of the year because they get sick regularly.
All right, I thought you were saying because it's important to me, I want to talk about it.
That's what you are saying. That's what I'm saying, and I'm saying that it's kind of funny.
No,
because you realize
it's
maybe
not that funny.
Because other people get what you had this once in 6 years, they may get it twice, three times a year. So they might be thinking about it more frequently.
All right. Anyway, well, you can bring it up, by the way.
Yeah, but you won't let me talk about it.
No, I like talking about medical stuff, but okay. I don't like talking about the real specific stuff. But something like the flu that everybody gets, I want to talk about.
All right.
Here's the deal. What about taking a Vicodin when your body's aching and your joints are hurting and your head is throbbing?
That helps.
No, thanks, Sam, for you, you're addicted.
Dr. Mike, the Armenian junkie from Salt Lake, is going to weigh in on this one.
If you do not have a family history of alcoholism and you are not vomiting, because the Vicodin will make the vomiting worse, possibly.
So that was my thing. I think I was vomiting.
I know, so you wouldn't
want to take it.
You wouldn't want to do it, yeah.
All right, but, okay. Go ahead, Mike.
I have a hard time trying to quit. I've been trying to do it. I enjoy it. So it's really hard, but, you know, I know it's bad, so I want to quit. The only problem is I can't really go into rehab because my dad's a cop, and, you know, it just if he finds out, it'll be the end of my life, basically. And I just I don't know if there's any ways if I could do it without, you know, going through rehab or...
No, unfortunately.
Well, how much are you taking? How much?
Well, it just depends on the day, but, you know, on an average day, I'll do about 9 or 10 pills of Loratab or, you know, whatever I can get my hands on. I just go from hospital to hospital and... have doctors write prescriptions or, you know, fake pain.
I'm sure there are days when you're doing 20.
Those days
will become basically the routine soon enough, and there will be more consequences and there will be legal problems. And I suggest you take care.
What kind of legal problems?
Somebody's going to see what
you're
going to get arrested. Yeah, one of the pharmacies is going to report you or something. But the point is, this is the most serious form of addiction. And it doesn't get better without treatment, and that's just the way it is. It's unfortunate. Just like if you had cancer and you were denying that you had it and didn't want to have it, I couldn't blame you, but you got it and you got to do something about it.
What type of long-term effects will I have? Like what's it looking out for?
Severe addiction. That's it. Severe addiction. And that's
I'm not going to ruin my liver or anything like that.
Well, interestingly, no, you're not, because whatever it is, I've dealt with Loratab and Vicodin addicts for years. My average Vicodin addict is taking, by the time they come to my treatment, they're taking about 50 tablets a day, which you'll get to eventually. Even then, they don't hurt their liver at all. And I've had people taking 100 tablets a day. What they do get...
Yeah,
what,
you just
what
came in 5 years.
No, I know. What they do get is deafness. That you can get sudden spontaneous deafness, and that it can be even at the lower doses, even at the therapeutic doses, it turns out. So that's the one thing you want to watch out for. And there's something about the way that people slowly escalate their Vicodin and Loratab use that the liver has a chance to adjust to all the Tylenol that's getting poured into it, and it builds the enzymatic machinery to be able to
to be able to deal with it. Yeah.
I need 70 of those.
So hey, I have centers confidential, so like my family won't find out. Or
yeah, at your age, you have a right to completely confidential health care. Yeah, if that's what
yes.
you want.
All right,
but you will need to tell someday. You will need to tell your family because you're as sick as yeah. It's part of
that's
the world
the eighth
here.
Step where they call me.
That's right.
They're crying. People I don't even know. Hey, listen, Drew.
Hey, what?
Let me say this, buddy boy.
Yeah.
What people don't really take into account, and like this guy Mike, you know, he's 21. He's taking a handful of those lower tabs. And is that for pain?
It's a pain pill, yeah. So originally it's for pain. And then there's the back pain and the headaches of chronic withdrawal that people think they're taking it for.
Right. Does it feel any different than Vicodin, that lower tab?
It's the exact same thing.
There it is.
Hydrocodone. Yeah, exactly.
All right, here's my point. These guys want to get back to zero. They want to beat the drug, not have the family find out, not miss any days at work, not lose the relationship, not have any consequences at all.
And feel normal again.
And they want to get back to zero.
Yeah.
And what they don't realize is, I'm screwing this up, but what I'm saying is, there will come a day when they'll wish they could get back to where they are right now.
That's true, because there will be more and more consequences. Yep.
Right, and they think they're looking to get to zero. You're never going to undo it. I mean, yeah. You're going to have to come clean to somebody. It's going to cost you a couple bucks. You might have to miss a few days of work. But there will come a day when you're going to be in jail. You're going to be dead. You're going to be strung out. You're going to forget.
Right.
This will be the least of your worries, missing a couple weeks of work.
That's right.
You'll be longing for the couple weeks of work thing when you're in the joint.
The switch has been thrown on this disease, and once it's active, that's it. It's game on.
Right. And if you think your dad is going to be pissed by this, he'll be more pissed when you're actually he's arresting you.
Yeah, that's right.
That's what I'm saying. I think that's the part that people screw up on, Drew, is they don't want to give up anything.
But they delude themselves. And, again, I don't know if it's the nature of the condition or the way our culture doesn't come to terms with this disease. They delude themselves into believing that if they could just stop, get off the drug, just get detoxed, then I'll be fine. Well, it simply isn't the case. It just isn't the case. All right. Here we go. This is Sam, 22.
Hi. I've... two unrelated but pertinent questions.
Uh-huh.
One is, I've been on Depo-Provera for about a year and a half now, and in the last few months, I've experienced really heavy bleeding.
So you had no period for a long time?
No discernible period, like no...
But you get what I'm saying. The usual situation is people bleed steadily for 3 months and then have stop their period after that. And then sometimes... Sometimes it comes back again later.
I had spotting for about 3 months, and then it was gone. And in the last 3 months, it's been continuous. I guess you could call it heavy spotting. It's not a very heavy flow or anything like that. But
good times.
Good times.
It's pretty much, constant fun. So I haven't been able to get any real answers from the doctor that I go to. They give the kind of shocked expression like, oh, well, that's not right. You should really talk to someone about that. Here's your shot, and
the gynecologist says you should talk to someone.
Just going to a clinic or something.
Yeah,
right?
Well, I'm with Kaiser, you know.
Mm-hmm. You see a physician though?
I do have the same gynecologist, but they kind of push me off.
But you see a physician, they say you should talk to someone.
Yeah, I've checked out the website.
Wait! How can the doctor? Who's the doctor expect you to talk to if not him or her?
No idea.
I don't think that's what they tell you, because you were talking to someone about it.
Let me rephrase that. I go in to see the gynecologist regularly, and I tell her about those issues. And she says, well,
don't worry about it.
It might be time to get you on some new birth control, but we'll see about that later.
Correct. Let me interpret that. Don't worry about it. Don't worry about it. It's a normal side effect of the shot.
This
far out, it does happen. It does happen, but it can be kind of, sometimes is a sign that it is time to use something a little different.
Okay.
It's no big deal, but it's a sign that you're going to have more of that kind of thing, and you might want to switch pills.
Drew.
Or the patch.
Yeah. I haven't brought this up in a while, but a marketing move, putting the Permanente behind the word Kaiser. Great idea for a hospital.
Yeah.
Just putting the word Permanente. You ain't never leaving. You'll be leaving with a toe tag. Kaiser Permanente. Here's why I think Permanente. I think bad 70s hairdo or permanent. I don't know. Who didn't? It's sort of like UPS, you know, what can Brown do for you?
Yeah.
Like, no one ever raised their hand at the meeting and said, fellas, we can't do better than this. This, what can Brown do for you? Like, I think of my Long Johns when I think about what Brown did for me.
From now on, I'll be thinking about that, that's for sure.
Yeah, I mean, there's certain things New Coke comes to mind, but I just mean the Permanente. I don't know what happened. Were they bought by the Permanente Insurance Group, or could they have changed the name? That it just seems like the world's worst idea, putting the word Permanente behind the hospital. And by the way, my family's a member of this Kaiser, and listen, everyone's always complaining, I got to wait in line, I don't have my own doctor, it takes 6 months. You pay $8 a month.
Right.
What the hell do you want, you people? You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Yeah, you want to know why you wait in line? Because it costs $8 a month. That's if it costs $500 a month, there'd be no lines, and you'd be complaining about how much it cost. That's how it goes, you idiots. Jesus Christ. I got to do the math for everybody?
Sounds like you've been talking to your family lately.
Listen, Kaiser's going to put a hit on my grandmother. My grandmother's been to that Kaiser like 700 times in the last 6 months. And eventually, and Drew, I know they have mercy-killing squads, do they not?
Kaiser does, of course.
Well, I just mean every major
corporation
insurance
does.
Group. That's how you keep profits up. You got to keep the shareholders happy, right?
Yeah,
I mean, I'm talking about guys in pork pie hats and Hawaiian shirts and wraparound sunglasses just going around, cleaning up the loose ends. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about.
That would make sense.
All right, here is Christina.
What was Sam's second question? She had a second question.
Well,
you start going off.
Do you want to hear it?
Well, you just start going off about Permanente.
Christina, hold on a second. Let's see. Where is Sam here? Sam, what's your second question?
You know what? I'll skip the second question since it's involved. But I will say, please, no more Dr. Bruce and no more Stryker. I know Jeff's irritated with Dag, but that was, if Adam's got to be gone, please let it be Dag. And Dr. Alter's okay. But
this is true. You're going to go to jail, buddy.
No more Dr. Bruce and no more Stryker. Stick with Dag.
We love Stryker. Stryker hasn't filled in a long time, has he?
No, I don't think so. It's been a while.
When has Stryker been here last?
I can't even remember. It's been a while.
Well, now, get her back on for a second.
No, look, with all my other boyfriends, I've only given them hand jobs.
Are you still there?
Hello?
No, she's not there anymore.
All right, so no more Stryker, no more Bruce. That's gonna send Bruce over the edge.
Love Bruce. I think Bruce is the best fill-in.
Bruce is going to turn that laser on himself. All right, we got to take a break. Should we take a break?
Yeah, sure.
Let's take a break.
All right.
Dr. All right. Drew over there in New York, the real McCoy, and I'm out here in LA, and we'll be right back after this. Hey, everybody, it's Loveline. Adam, that's Dr. Drew over there in New York. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Hey, Drew.
Yeah.
We always laugh about the radio station and the folks that work in it.
Yeah.
Like when you open the refrigerator in the kitchen and there's a half-eaten can of Chef Boyardee raviolis with a balled up paper towel shoved into it to keep it fresh, to keep the three ravioli at the bottom of the can fresh. Remember I dragged that mess in?
Oh, yes.
The other thing, too. So here's the thing about radio stations, everybody. Technically, adults work here, but practically it's children, right?
Well, let's put it this way. People over the age of 21 work here.
That's the only thing that makes them adults.
That's right.
I mean, because what 42-year-old guy eats Chef Boyardee ravioli and then shoves the can back? And I mean, The only thing that the only food I could think of that would be worse than Chef Boyardee ravioli is 2 day old Chef Boyardee ravioli.
Did you
see
find,
what I'm saying?
Did you come across something?
No, here's what I came across. You know the vending machine that's in the hall by the kitchen?
Yeah.
There's that big sign on it that says, "This is broken. This machine took our quarter," and it like wrote censored, actually didn't want to use any profanity. Yeah. Under that sign is a whole list of adults, I'm holding my fingers up, who've had their quarter stolen, and it's like, Rick, 217, one quarter. Johnny, 217, two quarters. Bobby, 218, one quarter. And that's like a line nine people deep of a-holes have lost a quarter? What the? You got to write down when you lost a quarter? Right? What? Oh, this is so when the guy comes to repair the machine, they can go, oh okay. Now, that's documented there. You see, there's a picture of me. There's a picture of me holding that day's newspaper, standing next to the machine with nothing coming out. Here is the dollar that I used to put in to make. So what, 3 weeks from now, you can get your quarter back after a lengthy argument with the vending machine guy?
Well, Adam, you may be literally a millionaire, so it doesn't matter to people like you. But
yeah.
To the average working stiff, it's a big deal.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that quarter.
Yeah. Yeah.
You're writing your name on a list saying that you got your quarter stolen. And by the way, that list is 12 people deep. What's the 12th person excuse? You know what I mean? You got all the dates and all the quarters. A graveyard of quarters over there. It's devastating.
In other words, why did the subsequent guys put their money in the machine?
That's right.
Yes.
That's right. Like if I'm the vending machine guy, I'm like, listen, I go four names deep and then I cut off. Yeah. You people, you've learned a valuable lesson that's gonna be worth much more than a quarter to you. The other other thing I was thinking about is I was telling you Thursday there was a beheaded rat that was on my steps.
Yeah.
And when I got back, it was waiting for me.
Yeah.
The beheaded rat just right at the landing at the top of the stairs. And I thought, what am I going to do with this rat? How am I going to get rid of it? And, there's never a flathead shovel when you need it. So I thought, I'll pick it up by the tail and I'll hurl it across the street and into like this down the hill, this vacant area.
By then you will have plague.
Yeah. Yeah. Oh, that's one of my wife's flu theories, by the way. Yeah. So... I picked the rat tail up.
Tularemia, maybe, but I don't know about flu.
I picked the rat up by the tail, the headless rat, and as soon as I picked it up by its tail, its innards fell out through its neck, and I immediately dropped the rat. And I thought, you see what happens when you try to be a hero?
Nice.
This is what happens. So I then found a rag that was lying around, picked the rat's tail up by the rag. And by the way, this is all... The only reason this move is made is so when my wife leaves for work in the morning, she doesn't see the rat and have a heart attack. Take the rat, tail by the rag, by the tail, using the rag as a forceps. Attempt to fling it using the rag, but of course screw up and have the thing land in the street directly across from my wife's car door on the driver's side. So she's sure to step on it. At that point, I just looked at it and I thought, I've done enough. You know what I mean? Like, you know that part where it's like my work is done here? I can technically say I tried.
You've
and
done
now I'm walking
harm.
Away. I
well, did it's that, only going to get worse.
Yeah, I did that dealer thing they do in Vegas. You know, the blackjack dealer? I'm out. That's it. Yeah. I'm going to go up and vomit now. All right. Nice when the innards fall out in a nice pouch from inside the rat when you pick it up by the tail.
Yeah, that is disgusting.
Okay. All right. Who are we talking to?
Christina, 18.
Yep.
Yeah.
What's happening?
Okay. My question for you is, what's the deal? Like...
Why do guys have a problem kissing the girl after she's performed oral sex on them? They shouldn't, depending on how far the oral got, right, Drew?
Yeah. And I think she means...
Were you depressed?
No, I'm just not wanting to
answer. Well, let me talk to Christine again.
All right. Yeah. She's there.
Christina.
Oh, Anderson did that. So she must be gone, I guess.
Must we go back to Christina?
Yeah, Anderson's done.
All right. I don't know.
But just say answer it. Guys aren't as good as showing their love. You know what I mean?
Remember how I didn't want to touch that rat tail?
There you go.
That's the same thing.
It is the same thing. Let's switch
guys
gears.
Guys don't want to make out with a part that's been on their part immediately after. Makes you kind of gay. I hate to say it, Drew, but it makes you gay.
A Germany or Florida. This is Mac 19.
Hey, guys. I just want to say, first of all, that this show is the only radio that I listen to aside from National Public Radio.
Oh, really?
That's kind of a special thing for you, I think.
Yeah.
Thank you. I appreciate
that. I'm not your regular demographic.
Well, maybe at 19 you're not their general demographic at NPR.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah.
God, I wanted to kick those sandal-loving commies in the nuts when I saw how nice their studios were.
Oh, I know. Oh, yeah.
We're operating out of a dump known as Westwood One for years, and they're in this beautiful, palatial place, high-tech.
Yeah, I was answering pledge drive phones there. It's really nice.
Well, it depends which city you're into. It doesn't matter which city you're in. Every city has got a great NPR studio.
Yeah. Yeah. So. I like their shows, too.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Okay, so the Germany or Florida?
All right.
Drunken 31-year-old man walks into
Florida.
The hospital complaining of severe abdominal pain.
Mm-hmm.
A radiograph shows an intestinal obstruction.
Yeah.
After interrogation, the man explains that he swallowed a condom filled with beer.
With beer.
With beer, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah. The condom had to be punctured through the abdominal wall with a needle, and 40 milliliters of beer were drawn off transcutaneously.
Wow.
The condom was passed the next day with his stool. And there's a hint on this. It took place in September.
Wow.
In September, well, that goes close to October, Adam, which would be the Oktoberfest.
And they pulled the milliliters of beer, but anything they pull out of you in a hospital gets converted into metric, right?
Yeah. So metric is, although not reported by the newspaper necessarily in metric, but...
probably it's the only one they got. And when he said subcutaneously, so they...
I mean, they put a needle through his abdominal wall.
Yeah. They pulled it out of his stomach?
They pulled the beer out of him? Well, they probably did it with an... Probably it couldn't pass the duodenum, and they just put it right through the abdominal wall.
The duodenum.
Yeah.
Now, how much beer do they get out of there?
40 milliliters.
40 cc's.
Oh, well, now, hold
That's
on
not
a
that
second.
Much. It's not that much.
40, because one of those bottles of wine is like 750 milliliter, right?
Yeah.
So 40 is not much.
No, but it's
enough.
What
the hell are you swallowing a condom with?
That's the question.
Half a beer in it.
Yes. What was the point?
Man, the beer feels German. The September feels German. The swallowing the condom feels Floridian.
No. You know what? It's
kind of give
too,
us a clue,
too,
but what kind of clue? Maybe he's trying to throw us off.
Well, September, October, Oktoberfest, but it's Bauhaus. It's creative. You know what I mean? It's like an artistic maneuver.
German. But I don't trust this Mac.
Yeah, I don't either.
Mac tried to give us a hint.
Yeah, I have another question for you, too. So.
Well, hold on a second. I'm going to go against Mac and his tips.
Okay, go Florida.
I don't know. He said he likes this show. Jesus Christ. All right, let's go Germany.
All right, I'm with you.
Germany it is. Yeah, Munich.
Yeah.
September, because in Germany, Oktoberfest happens the last week of September.
See what you get from listening to Morning Becomes Eclectic? All right. What's the next question?
Also, I'm an architecture student, and Adam, I know you used to work in construction, and I'm really interested in sustainability and closing the loop, the material loop, and I'm wondering what sort of construction waste you think is unnecessary, and how would you go about getting rid of it?
So you're talking about like sort of ecology.
Exactly.
Ecology or efficiency?
Both.
Both.
Ideally, you reuse everything that you have. Yeah. You know, if you're making a concrete formwork.
Actually, Adam is pretty good at this. He designs. He's sort of a genius at this stuff. He does it in real time, right, Adam? What'd you say?
Well, you know, stuff designing you and engineering?
Well, the stuff you design and the choices you make as you're building have maximum efficiency.
Well, I'm a genius.
Well,
yes,
you said all your people you have working for you are throwing stuff away that you wanted to reuse. Remember that? The plywood or something?
Yeah, well, they're just stupid. That's all. Here's what's happening. They're getting into all this. They're figuring out ways to reuse a lot of stuff and make a lot of structural lumber now, and engineered lumber, they call it, mm-hmm. you know, out of all the pulp and all the stuff, and, you know, instead of just cutting down big trees. But the most wasteful part of the construction process,
right?
I mean, I would say in general, there'll come a time, and it's already coming, where you'll just order everything prefabbed. You'll order all your walls prefabricated. I mean, you know, if you think about the biggest effect on the environment, it's the R value being wasted, you know, all the heating going out the window and through the cracks and all that kind of stuff. Yeah,
that is interesting.
So I mean, that's a bigger impact than a 2x4 getting wasted.
I would think it was the beer cans not being recycled.
It has to do with, oh, come on, Anderson, we're getting serious for a second here. Here's my point. When you order a huge pile of lumber and then frame a house out of that huge pile of lumber, there's going to be a lot of waste, as opposed to ordering all the walls prefabbed and tilting them up. So I think the more prefabricated things get, the more efficient they'll get and the less waste they'll get, just like a factory. You know what I mean? I mean, when you're building one Ford Model T, there's going to be a lot of waste, but when you're building a million of them, you'll do it in a much more efficient fashion. All right. Thank you. And mahalo.
Thanks for
All right, buddy. True. What about it?
What about it? About what?
I don't know. Modern building techniques?
It's fascinating to me, but I know nothing about it.
All right, buddy.
All right. Good times. Who's time next? For the break, huh?
Really?
Yeah.
Let's go out on a Loveline call. Who do we got over there?
Can we take the line three there, Anderson? Anna?
Yeah, I put her on hold. I'm not sure. Maybe we should check during the break.
Okay.
All right. What's up with Anna?
She's got another one of those calls like Christina had.
A little filthy, huh?
Yeah.
All right. Let's
take this. Well, here we go. Here we go. This is Lena 20. Lena?
Yeah.
Hey.
Hey. You guys going to get on?
There you are.
Oh, you made it. What's up?
Okay. So this is the deal. I'm old, and I've been a virgin my whole life until about 2 months ago. I was on a date with this guy, and he date-raped me. And I was just wondering, about 3 days afterwards, I got my period, but I haven't gotten it since then. It's almost 2 months ago, and I was wondering if there's a possibility I could be pregnant.
Mm-hmm. Do you want me to answer that, or do you want to go to break?
Let's go to break. But hold on. Let me just find out. How did this date rape work? Did you report him?
No.
What happened?
Well, we're actually really good friends. And he said he wanted to take me out, and so we went on a date together, and we went back to his house afterwards, and he wanted to, and I didn't, but he was bigger than I am, so it didn't really matter.
Did he just keep pushing and pushing?
He held you down?
Yeah.
And
with a weapon or something?
No.
Oh, but he was so much bigger. Did you yell for help?
Yeah, but it was really loud. There were a lot of people. He lives in apartments, and there were a lot of people in the apartment next to his.
Did you try to run away?
I guess they're having a party over there, so.
But you didn't report him.
Mm-mm.
Well, why not?
I don't know.
Did you try to run?
She was running on top of her.
But did he hold you back when you kicked and screamed, tried to run away?
Mm-hmm.
He actually held you. Wow.
All right, put her on hold, Drew. Okay. I know what yours. Listen, we're both suspicious now, because why didn't she report him? I, by the way, and I know this sounds horrible, but so is everything else I say. I couldn't imagine being able to physically rape somebody. I mean, have penetration with somebody who I didn't say. You know, I could imagine saying, "Look, I'm going to kill your kids unless you hold still and let me have sex with you." That I could understand. I don't mean understand, but I could physically see you pulling
off. How do you physically pull off sex with a bobcat?
That's what I'm saying. I mean, when it's nothing but teeth and nails and screaming and kicking, I don't know how you get... I know how you grab a boob. I can't imagine actually having intercourse with that person. And, yeah, I understand the part where they say something like, make any noise and I'll break your neck, and the person... hold reasons, still, yeah. And that's part of the crime. But I'm just saying, I'm always a little suspicious in these situations. And we should talk to her and find out what the hell's up with her past and all that. Yep. And maybe she will bring charges against this guy.
Yeah.
All right. Well, take a break. We'll get back with Lena. We'll answer a question about pregnancy and all that. Oh, I'm gonna get some change and hit the vending machine. Drew, you want anything?
The nuts.
Yeah, I'm going to the Pepsi machine with the list of losers.
Oh, it's Diet Coke. Thank you. Yeah.
Right. Hey, should I just write my FU loser 50 cents and write the date? I'm going to do that. All right, I have Chris do that. All right, after this. Hey, everybody. Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew out in New York. Just looking at the schedule, Dave Navarro's coming in here a little bit later this week.
Right.
Drew, you'll be happy to know that I saw him on his television show with Carmen Electra. I think Till Death Do Us Part, where they're getting ready to get married. He went on down for a colonic. Oh. And I know you have some thoughts about that. He needed to detoxify. He needed to rejuvenate.
Good times.
Yeah, it's always the same broad working at that place, too. It's that super husky, was a chain smoker, Bulgarian accent, heavy set usually, woman in her 50s.
Yes. Usually European sort of suspect nationality, unclear nationality.
Yeah, and never looks like things are going too good for them. You know what I mean? Like, you've been doing the colonics for 40 years, honey. You look like a sack of manure with a cigarette and some lipstick. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
How things been working out for you? Hey, Drew, what does that colonic do? Nothing?
Nothing.
Just pulls the duke out of you?
Pulls the duke out of you. How could... I mean, just think about it. It's all outside your body.
But, Drew...
It's like
the
washing
toxins,
your skin.
Okay, the toxins... Your body's like a thermos, okay? And the toxins come in, okay? First off, everything... We're living in a toxic environment, okay? The carpeting in your house, okay? Toxic. That car you're driving behind on the freeway, stuck in traffic, toxins pouring out. The meat you're eating, filled with toxins and hormones. The vegetables, sprayed with toxins, okay? So those toxins all enter your body. You ever feel tired? Let me ask Engineer Chris. You ever feel tired? Have you ever felt tired? Yeah, you have. And sometimes when the alarm goes off in the morning, you don't feel like getting out of bed, do you? No, you
don't.
You know why? Sometimes your back will hurt. Okay, I'll tell you why. And sometimes you wake up and you're thinking, I'm not in a great mood. Why is that? I'll tell you why. Toxins. They're storing in your body, okay? They gather in your body. You start feeling run down. You have to flush those toxins out of your system and rejuvenate, okay? Okay, because you're walking around. You're like a big, you know what you are? You're a big toxin Bota bag. That's what you are. Your Bota bag filled with toxins. And what this does is it cleanses the toxins, okay? All right? You, as a doctor, you understand that, don't you? Do you not, Drew?
I do not. That's right.
Okay, great. Thank you. All right. It's just a bunch of crap, right?
Yes,
literally.
I mean, literally. First of all, no, the people are not biologists. They don't even understand what they're saying when they say toxins.
But Drew, if I put a hose up your ass and pump a few aquariums full of water through your lower intestine,
I'll feel better.
You'll feel better, right?
Yeah, of course. Anytime
you pull something out of your ass, you immediately feel better. But maybe it's a relative thing. You
why
know
does
what I mean? It's like I'm going to put your sack in a shop vise. When you release it, you feel better.
Why don't they get a colonoscopy when every speck is cleaned out of there so they can see every inch of the surface?
Yeah.
That makes you feel good. Hey, let's finish with Lena before.
It's not detoxifying.
Yeah. Lena.
Yes.
So
We wonder why you, what was the nature of the fight you put up and why you didn't report this guy. And it makes us think that perhaps that you're a trauma survivor and we're sort of set up as a victim.
Oh, no. I'm completely normal. I'm really lucky with, like, my past, like, my background, my history, my family and everything like that. I'm really lucky.
So is it just that this really didn't bother you that much? That's why you didn't report it? Or
no. What? I kind of felt like it was kind of my fault. I kind of felt like I kind of antagonized it. And see, okay, so this is what happened. So, like, we were, like, making out and everything. We were at his house after our date or whatever. We're at his house, and we're, like, making out and stuff. And basically, like, he kept bugging me about it, and I kept telling him that I didn't want to and all that. But he was on top of me, and basically, like, he was in me, and it really, 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 really hurt. And so, like, I started screaming, and I was telling him to get off me, and he didn't. Until, I guess, I don't know, it seemed like a really long time, but I guess it could have only been, like, you know, 10, 15, 20 seconds, something like that, but it seemed like a really long time. So, I mean, finally he got off me.
Right. Have you talked to him since?
Yeah, I see him every day.
And you're not angry at him?
No, I really am. I don't talk to him, but I have to see him because we go to school together.
Wow.
Wow.
We're running out of time. I would like to talk to her some more. I mean,
you ever wake up in the morning and feel tired, like you don't want to get out of bed?
She's a colonic. There you go.
All right. It sounds like an awful situation,
and yet he's kind of your friend, but he's kind of not, and you sort of feel guilty, but it really, you're guilty of him attacking you?
Here's the thing. I don't think you're going to sell this one to any judge.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It wouldn't be bad to get this guy on record. I mean, I'm just being realistic here.
But I'm not clear what happened, even.
He was in you.
Did you invite him in? No? Yes?
No.
All right. We're running out of time here. Here's the thing. Can she be pregnant?
Yes. It's very simple these days to get a pregnancy test. Go ahead and get one. And
he didn't have an orgasm, though, I don't think, did he?
I don't think. It's still possible, but it's not likely, but it's possible. Of course, just get a home pregnancy.
All right.
Check it out, and
be more careful and sorry. And
condoms.
And we'll be right back. Well, that's the show, everybody.
Mercifully. Nothing like listening to those public service announcements while I'm sitting here chilling.
Oh, yeah. You learn a lot of important things about nothing. Where's my PSA about why the goddamn sprinklers got to be on the side of the freeway during torrential downpours? All right, I guess we don't have the technology to take care of that. Well, when we're done with the next Mars probe, we'll get on that. Right. All right, Drew, God bless you there from New York. You're back in studio tomorrow night. Until next time, this is Adam Carolla for Dr. Drew saying mahalo. Look, I'm going to kill your kids unless you hold still and let me have sex with you. That I could understand.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station. The producer for Loveline is Ann Ingold. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.